were swept in the crowd. The result of the 75 bishops of us were not necessary and that. What was it? So God knew that some of us in their heart knew that only God can be a God. Because Satan's confession that he can be a God was not only blasphemous, it was also wrong. It was not possible for anyone else to function as a God in charge of a dominion and run it perfectly without disease, without accidents, without problems. Nobody can do that. Being swept in the crowd, I'm going to tell you about an experiment that some people did. In this experiment, I think a very simple experiment, there's an arrow like this with a two head. And so let's take two arrows. One of them has only one pointer, and the other has two points like that. Now, obviously, this one looks like this. But this one does not. So the experiment was to tell a group of people that let us agree that this arrow looks like this one. And then one member of the group was absent, and they said, "This is when he comes in, let's all say that this one looks like this one." And then ask him which one of these two looks like this one. And so so, when this fellow came in, they started to ask the question, which one of the two arrows looks like this one? And the group, one by one, said, this one looks like this one. This one here looks like this one. Until they reached the fellow, the protected victim, and they told him, they asked him, which one of these two looks like this one? And he said, this one looks like this one. He went along with the crowd. Now, you and I are sure that he knew that this one was a good one. In his heart, he knew that this one was a good one. But he probably said, maybe they know something I don't know. Maybe there's a trick here or something. So he went along with the crowd and said, this one was a good one. This is a real life experiment. And this is precisely what happened in that great feud. So the angels suggested that all the priests who do not uphold God's absolute authority must be thrown out and banished from God's kingdom. But because of God's knowledge that this fellow in his heart knew which the correct answer that he went along was swept in the crowd, some of us human beings were also swept in the crowd and we said that yeah, maybe Satan can do it. Let's see a demonstration. So God wanted to give us a chance. God is the Rahman al-Rahim. He is the most merciful. And he did not throw us out of his kingdom because of this crime that he committed, which is in fact the original sin. He wants to give us another chance to redeem ourselves, to denounce our crime, and to proclaim God's absolute authority of all. But only God can be the God. Okay, this calls for this second chance, a test was to be done in order for us to go through the same process. In other words, if you kept asking this person and say, are you sure that this one looks like this one? He would say, yeah, I'm sure. They just say, come on, think about it. This one has two pointers, this is only one, and this is two pointers. He will tell you, if you press him, he will say, well, I know that this one looks like this one, but everybody's saying this one looks like this one, so I thought maybe they know something I don't know. So this is the second chance. For the second chance, we learn from Surah 67 that God created death. There was no death. God created death. All the creatures who did not uphold God's absolute authority, who are to given a second chance, including the jinn and the humans, that, and they were to be brought into this, this universe, which is the smallest, the innermost of seven universes, to be born into this world, having no recollection whatsoever of the great youth or anything that happened in the first life. Quran calls it the first life, and this is the second life. This is the first life after that death. But we are born into this world without any recollection of what happened in the great society. And then we are given a message from God telling us we shall uphold God's absolute authority. We must worship only God, and we must know that God is the only one who possesses all power. And we are also given a message from Satan. Satan tells us God alone is not enough. There are also other entities that can have power, like Muhammad or Jesus or Mary or St. Francis or Imam Hussein. This is what Satan is pushing. And then we make a free will decision to uphold God's absolute authority, or repeat the crime that was committed in the past, and we say there can be other entities besides God that are powerful. In other words, we are given another chance to go back to God's kingdom or to join Satan's kingdom. This is why we are here. This is one of the main reasons for being here. Now, this was the first half of the answer that I talked about yesterday. And I want now to talk about the second half. Second half is that tragically, this being swept in the crowd is happening to many of us. Because the world is mostly oblivious to God. Those people driving out in the streets are just going about their business, totally oblivious to God. And they don't do anything to develop their soul, nourish the real person. They feed their bodies, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. They totally neglect the real person. They're feeding the garment, without the garment, this is not the garment. And they leave the real person. And some of us are being swept in the crowd. We're doing the same thing as they are. And if we decide to believe in God, even believe in God alone, that He alone is worthy of worship, we don't do enough to develop our soul. Because everyone else is not doing anything. So if one of us is doing only the morning prayer, some of us make funny statements like, oh, God should be happy in doing the morning prayer. Look at all those people doing nothing. I'm doing the morning prayer every morning. But this is, it is not enough. It is again being, it's repeating the mistake, the original mistake, being swept in the crowd. So the Quran teaches us in order to be saved, to be redeemed, and to go back to God's kingdom, we have to set a minimum for our salvation, a minimum amount of, I'm getting to call it gifts now, that we must give ourselves. We grow up thinking it is obligations, like the 5-day prayer. We've grown accustomed to certain duties, and they change into something like chores. So somehow Satan succeeded in convincing us that these are chores, or duties that we must do for God in order to be saved. It is all wrong. They are not chores, they are not duties or obligations. The Quran teaches that they are gifts from God. And when you do the 5-day prayers, God has given you a gift because you deserve it, and because He knew that in your heart, you knew that this one looks like this one, deep in your heart. Even though you said with your mouth that, yes, Satan can do it. Maybe. So He gives you this gift, and we see it in the Quran when the Prophet Abraham prayed. He said, Rabbi ja'alni muqim as-salah. This is what he prayed for. When we pray now, we pray for health or wealth. Please God make my kids receive the gift. Great age. But he prayed and he said, please God, make me one who observes contact prayers, but it's a gift from God. Because they are the needs for the real person. 5 meals a day. All of us were very careful to make sure that I'm going to have lunch today. Which is not really the case. It's not, I'm not going to have lunch today, I'm going to give my body lunch today. But if you realize that the 5 daily prayers, for example, are a gift from God, who is glad, who is eager to feed our souls, just like we are eager to feed our bodies. So let me go through this minimum. This would be the minimum for any believer in order to avoid being swept in the crowd. The 5 contact prayers. The second item I put here is Zakat. It will not be surprising that 99% of us right here in this room do not do the Zakat. And just to scare you a little bit, the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that He is going to restrict His mercy to those who give zakat. The verse says, وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. My mercy encompasses all things. This is what God says, وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. My mercy encompasses all things. فَسَأَكْتُبُهَا لِلَّذِينَ يَتَّقُونَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ. But I will restrict it for those who are righteous, who give these zakat. That's how important this item is, number 2. Zakat, the charity. And this is repeated in the Quran so many times. They ask the people in hell, why are you here? They say, we didn't feed the poor. Yeah. What is the answer? In fact, it is, we didn't observe the contact prayer, and we didn't feed the poor. مثل لكم في صفحة قالوا لكم من المصلين is not good at 5 prayers ولم لكم أول مسكين within these before. So these are the 2 most important. These have to be minimal for you. The 5, you must make a determination that you must feed your soul the 5 days of meal. Why not on this topic? The 5 basic meals. Quran, if you see my new translation, the theme of the new translation is right here. This is in the press. It will not be this big, so don't worry. Because this is only one side. But, as soon as you open the front cover, you're going to see this theme here, which says, surely those who believe, those who are Jewish, the Christians, the converts, anyone who, number 1, believes in God, and number 2, believes in the hereafter. And number 3, leads a righteous life, will receive the recompense from the Lord. They have nothing to fear, nor will they grieve. So the Jews, the Christians, the Hindus, the Buddhists, the Muslims, anyone who believes in God, this means God alone, and believes in the hereafter, and leads a righteous life, they have nothing to fear. Now, we read other verses in the Quran, so how does this fit with the 5 contact prayers? Because the Jews and the Christians don't do the 5 contact prayers. But if they satisfy these 3 requirements, they would be saved. But how does this fit with this other verse in the Quran tell us that anything righteous they do, they are rewarded for it. But it would be like living on snacks. It would be a slow process. It would be like going from here to there without a map. Going from San Francisco to Dallas, Texas, without a map. The 5 contact prayers are the fastest way of developing your soul, our soul. And we do learn this from the Quran. These righteous people will make it, but they will not make it to the degree or the rank or the extent that you can make it using the 5 basic prayers. Exactly like living on snacks. For the body. Give your body the potato chips and the sunflower seeds all day. A piece of candy here and there. But no basic meat. No main meat. This will stop your growth. You will not be healthy. But you still survive. not for a long time here. So the five contact prayers here, the five basic needs of the soul. The zakat, we thank God for teaching us how to do it right. Because everywhere in the Muslim world we do it wrong. The majority of Muslims in the world, they give the zakat if they do once a year. 2.5% of their savings that are 1 year old, about the 70 years. But this is what the Quran says, this is what God says. Surah 6, verse 131. God says, you must give the zakat on the day of harvest. And we don't harvest wheat or seeds, we harvest checks. This is what we harvest. Our salary, our income from trading, from investment, or sale. But the principle is that any time you receive money, you go into your pocket, that's your money, you must give, set aside at least 2.5% of that and give it away to a specific set of recipients in the Quran. And they are in this order, your parents. If they are rich, then you go to your relatives, your cousins, your sisters, brothers, nephews, nieces, aunts, uncles. This is the second category, number three. The term of the orphans. If you find some orphans, you have no support for an A parent or both them. The necessity of this means the food, any food people after that. The next category is the traveling alien. Somebody just came from Mexico, they don't have a job, and they're working on the immigration papers. They cannot work, they don't have a work permit. This is the next category. But the zakat must be given on your net income, 2.5% immediately. When you read the Quran, you see that zakat and salat, namaz and zakat are together, always, as if they are a daily process. In fact, at the first phase of the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah number 2, not the first phase, but the second phase. The definition of the righteous. They observe the contact prayers and spend from our provisions, which is these two. Right at the beginning of the Quran, these two points are mentioned. These are the minimum, number one and two of the minimum. By the way, the zakat as it is practiced in the Muslim world is not, it doesn't make sense. Because if you have a theoretical calculation, something, let's say you have 40 million dollars, and in the savings, you give 2.5% of that, $1 million. And then the following year, you have to give the cash again, you have $39 million left. The following year, you have to give another $1 million. It's not fair. According to the Quran, when you give the $1 million out of 40 million, you already purified these 40 million. They are yours. Pure and clean, and you no longer have to give the cash. According to the so called Islamic system, you have to give until you're broke. In the fact, the calculation goes up until you're broke. And that's what it is. 2.5% one time, net income when you receive, at the time you receive. Number three. Fasting during the month of Ramadan. And this goes a long way towards developing your soul. Because Siyah, Rose, during the month of Ramadan. Because every day in Ramadan, you're telling your body, you're not going to eat or drink until sunset. So this strengthens you. So God gave us a wild horse. This body is a wild horse. We're supposed to tame it. And God gave us the means to tame it and control it. Also, it's a measure of your degree of development. This will take me back to the prayers. The high contact prayers. Because you can measure your degree of development by, for example, the morning prayer, which is the first sunrise. It's very good for you physically also. you not develop arthritis, you do wake up in the morning and go to bed. I used to say this on a theoretical basis until I heard an advertisement. Maybe you also heard this from the Arthritis Foundation. Is to not lay in the same position, sit in the same position for a long time. Some truck driver will ask you, what do I have arthritis? And they said, every few hours, not get out and stretch. Now, when we go to sleep and sit like that, the joints become stiffer. They need to be lubricated. So God does not want to bother us and annoy us by asking us to get up before sunrise every day. He doesn't need to do that. We need it. So if we do it in morning prayer, I'm sorry I didn't get to the subject a little bit, but this is the physical part of it. That you get up and you lubricate your joints and you will not have arthritis when you grow up. You grow older. The spiritual part of it is you can measure the degree of your development. But as you become strong, you, not the body, you become strong, your body will become obedient to you. So you can measure if you wake up. If you cannot wake up at all in the morning, you're in bad shape. You cannot tell your body to get up for your own good for the morning meal, the morning prayer before sunrise. Because there is a fight between you and your body every morning. If you decide to do this, it comes tomorrow morning before sunrise and the body wants to sleep. But you need to make it wake up. So this struggle takes place, and one of you wins, either you or your body. Your body wins, you continue to sleep, and you will continue to be weak. If you win, you will grow, and you will develop, and the growth of the soul is very fast. Surah 17. It's the growth. See, we grow until we're 5 feet or 6 feet tall. So, the soul grows until it is bigger than San Francisco, the soul, your soul. So the degree of growth is the game, is fantastic. It's not like, we eat this food to grow, we're very limited to grow a lot of this. The soul grows immensely. So if you succeed in forcing your body to get up before sunrise and do the morning, make contact with you to the ether before sunrise, you grow a lot. So at first it will be difficult. But in a month or two, you will grow sufficiently that when you say to your body, get up and do the morning contact prayer, it will get up gradually. And this will show you the degree of your growth. You will be on your way. It'll be very good. Even though your body is getting up gradually, do that contact prayer, it's very good. Better than saying no and losing to your body. But gradually, as you grow stronger, your body will become absolutely obedient to you. This will tell you how much growth you attain. You come time before sunrise, you set the alarm. In fact, you will not need to set the alarm anymore. This is true. You will not need. You will wake up your body at the right time before sunrise. Get up with the contact prayer. And your body obediently will start to enjoy it. And this will tell you at what your degree where you stand. And eventually, you will really enjoy it. You will enjoy the morning prayer. It will be very cheerful. Most people get up in the morning and have a long day. But you will get up with a big smile every morning. So this will provide you with a yardstick as to the degree of your growth. Now fasting does the same thing. Because first thing in the morning, your body wants breakfast. And you issue a command. Your body, I'm not going to eat or drink. That's a good sunset. This will cause you to grow up. So God designed these things. Zakat also, you take your money, that most people love very much, and you give it away. So you can see that all these are designed for our benefit, to make our soul grow and develop. These are gifts from God. And if you are fortunate to receive the gift, you will do these things. It seems like what it takes is a decision. You decide that you want to worship God alone. Then God will give you this gift and you'll be able to do it. So your part is really very easy. All you need to do is a decision. I want to be redeemed, I want to be with God alone. I believe that Muhammad, Jesus, Mary, Hussein, Ali, not of the same power. Only God has all power. So what's this all you need is a decision. Then God will see that you do this thing. The fourth minimum is zikr. It's not called zikr, but I have to explain it. The Quran, there's a commandment in the Quran that's very important that says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe, udhkuru Allah zikran kathira. Remember God continuously, Allah, frequently. And this is not any ritual or anything that you perform. It's something that you do continuously. You look at this view and say, Subhanallah, God be glorified. You realize God's creation, the beauty that God created in the world. You look at the fruit, look how many flavors we have here. When I say the word orange, you think of a certain flavor. Then I say strawberry, and you think of a certain flavor. Strawberries have a color, texture, taste, flavor, smell. And these are all chemicals that God created in the strawberry. There's peach. When I say that word, you think of it. So when you look at this, Subhanallah. And God didn't have to do all this. But this is dhikr. When you say Subhanallah, when you think of God's creation, God's greatness, this is what we do, dhikr. But let me start from the beginning. The minimum that you want to set for yourself is start when you wake up in the morning. The first thing you must say in the morning must be the name of God. First thing you say. In this country, most people start with a dirty word in the morning, every morning. When the alarm goes off. You want to start with the name of God. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. La ilaha illallah. There is no God except the one God. It's going to take you 3 or 4 months if you're not doing it already. It's going to take you 3 or 4 months at least to get used to it. The first thing you do when you open up your eyes, this is dhikr. Because what you utter, the first thing you say in the morning, every morning, this is what you will utter when you get up in the day of resurrection. The real life, the eternal life, that will determine your rank forever. And you don't utter a dirty word in the day of resurrection. So this is the first thing we do, and of course we do the morning prayer. There are certain commandments in the Quran, the straightforward commandments that you must do to carry out this gift. For example, in Surah 18, God says, do not say I will do anything without saying inshallah. God will. Do not say about anything. Indi fa'il in thalik al-ghadan, I'm doing this tomorrow. Illa an yasha Allah. Without saying inshallah. You must never say I'm going to see you tomorrow. And that's it. Do not say I'll see you tomorrow, God will. Even when you work with the Americans, or non-Muslim. At first you'll be shy. You're afraid to say, what is this? And they will say that. They'll be taken aback. You'll say, God willing. But eventually they will respect you. And you will get used to it. And you'll be carrying out your duty. You're actually reminding the people of that creator. So I'm going to finish this at 6 o'clock, God willing. And it must become a habit. Again, it will take you 3 or 4 months. But this is a commandment in the Quran. Do not say, I will do anything, without saying, inshallah. The Quran gives you a commandment also, that if you want to invoke protection for your children, for example, or your car, or your property, you must say, mashallah. This is Surah 18 also. This man who lost his garden. God says, if only when you entered your garden, you said, mashallah, complete step is mashallah that was in the event. You would not have lost your garden. So this tells us that in order to invoke protection for your own children, your own property, your own car, you say, MashaAllah, you start the car and start like that, very nicely. Say, MashaAllah. Now before you start, say, Bismillah, see? This is what dhikr is. You must seek every chance to mention God. This is because we came to the realization, and this is very important, that your God, who's your God? Let me stop here and ask the question. Don't answer me. It's in your mind. In your mind. Your mind answers. Who is your God? Well, every one of you is saying, my God is the creator of the heavens and the earth. And most of you are wrong. You were shocked when you came to this realization. When we came to this realization and I was taken Friday, 7, we were all shocked because we examined ourselves as to who is our God. But it turns out, when we study the Quran carefully, that your God is whoever or whatever occupies his mind most of the day. And we examined ourselves and we found that the creator of the heavens and the earth was not our God. We thought we were believers and we thought our God was the creator of the heavens and the earth. And this was the thing that, and this is the answer that the Quran gives, describing many people who are headed, going to hell. At the end of Surah 23, for example, if you ask them, who is the Lord of the heavens and the earth and the Lord of the great dominion? Where did you go wrong? So here they're saying, God, the Lord of the heavens and the earth. But you see, they're saying with their mouth, and this is the answer of their mind, but they are preoccupied with other things. Therefore, this is why the commandment to remember God constantly is very important. At least 51% of the day. And it's very easy. I know you're thinking, it's very difficult. How can I tell? I'm at work and busy with the computer and so I'm having a sense of God. It's really very easy. Because when you're doing the computer, you see somebody put a flower on the desk or something. You see flowers on the desk. You look at the design of the person, subhanAllah, that's a good one. This will satisfy a good require will interrupt you your thinking and concentration of the world. And you think of God. By the way, I go back to the contact prayers. The five contact prayers go a long way towards this. Remembering God. As a matter of fact, you look up Surah 20, verse 14. God says, observe the contact prayers to remember me. Salat and dhikr. This is God says. This is the reason for giving you this gift. Cause you to remember God, because it is not just the 2 minutes. You know, we went back there and prayed the afternoon prayer, 2 minutes. It is not just those 2 minutes that are counted in your family as credit for you. 2 hours ago, we looked at the water and said, it's not afternoon prayer today. In that, you remember God there. And this goes to the credit. And an hour later, we said, is it time for the afternoon prayer? No, it is not. So you're thinking of God. What is afternoon prayer? You're not doing it to get a salary, to be paid. You do it for God. And just thinking about it. So the 5 prayers, when you go to sleep, you say, I hope I get up before sunrise tomorrow to pray the morning prayer. That is it. The 5 prayers every day is why it's the most important minimum gift to your soul. The 5 prayers. They go a long way towards making the creator of the heavens and the earth, your God, and not your job, or your spouse, or your children, or your property. These are the gods that are counted in the Quran. The gods that are counted in the Quran include spouses, a man who worships his wife instead of God, or a wife who worships her husband instead of God. Children, giving more attention to our children than to God. These are also counted as God, who are children. Surah 7 is the verse of Allah. Remember it says that the wife becomes pregnant and the load becomes heavier and heavier, and then they pray to God, please God give us a good baby. And then So that they give them a good baby, they turn the baby into a god. So it's very clear. And the Surah 18, the person who lost his garden, the garden was his property, his business, his job. The ego, the number of Surah 25, the ego can stop you from being saved. The ego, next. So, in order to, the five prayers and this text will help you as to who your God is. The creator of heaven will help you be your God through this text. It's very important to mind. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا وسبحوه بكرة وأصيلا من تسبيح day and night. Day and night. This is how we get saved. Then, when I ask you, who is your God, and you find yourself the creator of the heavens and the earth, you'll be right. Only through this. Through this. As it is, when we examined ourselves some time ago, and we discovered that we slumped, that the creator of the heavens and the earth was not our God. We were preoccupied with other things. Then we set the minimum for this. First thing in the morning, the five prayers. You look at your child and you say, MashaAllah, God gave me this. This is God's gift to me. And this immediately invokes protection for your child. There's a mechanism for it. It's very physical. Because when you say, MashaAllah, immediately answers with God for your child. And your child can go ride the bicycle and go between the traffic and hide. Maybe a bit too dangerous. But yes, your child will be protected even on our side anywhere. So there's a mechanism for it. When you say, MashaAllah. So, inshaAllah is a command. When you say, I'm going to do anything in the future, you must say, inshaAllah. MashaAllah. Alhamdulillah. Oh, there is a commandment that says, do not eat from anything upon which the name of God was not pronounced. And although I tend to think this applies to meat, I think it applies to eggs and peach and orange. So, before you eat, say Bismillah. Okay? Before you start anything, before you start your fast, say Bismillah. This are all just chances that you must grab to make God our God. And not our job, or our business. But this will give you everything else. This will guarantee you your job, it will guarantee your children, it will guarantee your spouse, and so on. So this is, I would say this is the thing maybe number one. The contact will go a long way towards that. Now the idea behind all this is we don't want to repeat the mistake that we did in the past. Billions of years ago. You don't want to be swept in the crowd. It doesn't matter if the people around you do not do the five prayers. You do it. And don't let Shaitan tell you, oh, God should be happy with one prayer. I'm doing the morning prayer. So that should be enough. I'm better than all these people. Yes, you are, but it's not enough. You're not giving yourself the proper meaning. So I think I will stop at this and let the questions or the discussion. Without reminding you, without anything. This is the basic idea as to why we are here. We thank God that He let us know first why we are here. He gave us a very sharp, clear picture to our generation. We wouldn't know this 20 years ago. We were born more than 20 years earlier. We wouldn't know this. God let us know that we were doing everything wrong. Everything we were doing, everything we grew up doing was wrong. The namaz was wrong, the zakat was wrong, the fasting was wrong, the hajj was wrong. We neglected the dhikr. And God, out of His mercy and grace, He taught us the correct way to do. So, we have to, right now, we should turn to God mentally and thank Him for showing us the right way, and at the same time make a pledge that we will rejoin God's kingdom, the root of all these things, including the mental health services. Just 1 minute to respond to this.
If you had to make a study of this
Once in a lifetime. Perhaps your husband says you can afford me. Wait until you save enough money. You'll do as much shopping. Then when you afford it, you can make hajj. I didn't talk about hajj here because it's once in a lifetime, but people who perform hajj destroy it by going to the Prophet Muhammad's mosque and they go and commit idol worship. And the tomb destroy hajj. We were destroying the mass by mentioning the names of Muhammad and Muhammad, Ibrahim and Ibrahim in the Salat. So what is happening now is God is purifying all these things for us. We must be devoted to God alone. The Shaitan will always push somebody. So they mention somebody next to God. In fact, the first pillar of Islam, if you want to come to the tradition of five pillars, which is called Shahada. It is stated in the Quran, لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. Surah 3 verse 18. شهد الله أنه لا إله إلا الله. This is the Shahada. Now when we grow up, they thought the Shahada is أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. Now this destroys the Shahada. First commandment in the Bible, the Old Testament, the New Testament, the Quran. It is لا إله إلا الله. When you add another name, there's no what Muhammad wants. There's what Shaitan wants. And another purpose for us is that only the hypocrites will say, this is what Allah is, not this is what Muhammad will do. Yeah.
What are the different conclusions that you have to the creatures of magic or the often crazy?
Very good question. A very good question. We did this earlier today. Surah 73, God says, remember God, two thirds of the night, one third of the night, or one half the night. It's all in the Surah. Little less, a little more. Okay, now we have to understand that the night in the Quran begins at sunset. And also in the Torah, in all the scriptures, the night begins at sunset and ends at sunrise. Now, if you do the five contact prayers, we'll satisfy that requirement. Because you're going to do the sunset prayer at 7 o'clock, you're going to do the night prayer at 9 o'clock or 9:30, and you're going to do the dawn prayer at 5 o'clock in the morning. So, from 7 to 10, that is 3 hours at the beginning of the night, and from 5 to 7, that's 2 hours in the morning. That's 5 hours, that's already 4:30 of the night. Almost half an hour. This is what it means. If you misunderstand that you get up in the middle of the night and you do if you do the five prayers, also in addition to the five prayers, there is a strong recommendation in Surah 17 to read the Quran as law. So you get up before sunrise and you do the morning prayer and read the Quran. This will satisfy the requirement of just
I have a question about social justice. If you're using of your time through the past, trying to change oppressive conditions or trying to alleviate suffering, is that a form of giving?
Yes.
Working for justice?
Yes. Yeah. Well, remember, there's no substitute for Zakat. Zakat is a very specific gift from God. It has to do with your income. Any time you receive money that becomes due, you say, God, go and ask yourself and give it away to the people that are there. But giving from your time to social justice and all other things, it's called Salat. It's another name for charity. But the sister behind you, I have a question.
Yeah, do you believe any other prophet besides God leading us?
Any idol?
Any other power?
Power, I think, without needing us, there's no other power than the other power.
So why do we have to say, already he's power, he's leading us, why do we have to say him all the time?
Because you can give it up. You can give up God's power and God's protection.
He doesn't need that, does he?
No, he doesn't need it. It's all for us. Nothing. None of this is forgotten. Is this why God created the earth in this way? What way? Our universe has a billion galaxies. One billion galaxies. But let me start from here. The solar system. The solar system is very small compared to the rest of our universe. And it is 2 billion, not miles across. 2 billion miles across.
Thank you.
No. My solar system. Solar system. The light comes up from the sun in 8 minutes. 93 million miles away. The sun is 93 million miles away. That's the longest. So the light takes light 8 minutes to come here from the sun. The solar system itself is 2 million miles across. The solar system is a very small component of the galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy. The Milky Way galaxy is 100,000 light years across. I'm not talking about that anymore. 100,000, you travel at the speed of light, imagine, sun, 90 million miles, light comes in 8 minutes. You cross the Milky Way galaxy, 100,000 light years, at the speed of light, 100,000 years. There are 1 million of these galaxies, 1 billion, excuse me.
Yet, whenever they say a sign, they see a sign of it. They turn away saying, this is real magic. They disbelieve and follow their own opinion and what they could physically think. They have received enough knowledge to set them straight. Great wisdom has come to them, but the warning seems to be useless. Therefore, leave them alone. The day will come when the caller calls them to something evil. Their eyes will be humbled. Say they come out of their grave, like the storm of the Luca.
I don't want to waste your time by asking him for evidence or proof that somebody paid me or somebody else millions of dollars to destroy the Sunna of the Prophet. Are you aware that God makes a lot from all the believers?
Why don't you say
Salat to me too? So why don't you, when I mention Hadith and say
Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam?
Yes, please pray for me too.
I know, I pray for all Muslims.
When Muhammad called people, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when called Abu Bakr Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam,
but yes, if your intention, you see, if your intention is clean, God will reward you for your intention. But if your intention is dirty, to make people turn their back away from the Sunnah of Rasulullah, that's not nice.
So is lying Sunnah of the Prophet? Is the Prophet lie?
Never.
Why do you lie?
I never lie.
Have I received millions of dollars?
I said my feeling. Yes. I never said I have a proof, otherwise I would show it everybody.
What?
But in my heart,
you said something like that.
Okay, then you are aware.
That good in my mind, you see, okay? It's a big sin because you are going to, for example, you don't know anything about that one. But if you change my mind, okay?
Simple.
But you try to...
Let me ask a question. Are you aware? Are you aware of the Quranic law that says, in the Ba'd of London, a little bit of suspicion is simple? So you are here. Is it a Sunnah of the Prophet to commit sin? To be suspicious? So why do you suspect that I took millions of dollars to...
Because what you're doing, you're doing itself, is a clear sign to me that they stopped fighting the Quran, and now they are fighting the Sunnah.
So what is your proof? What is the sign that I have millions of dollars?
I think another reason is that
they're
not being
talked
about. Was Muhammad Sunnah or Shia?
Muhammad was not Sunni, was not Shia.
So how come you are Sunnah?
I am not Sunnah. I am not Sunnah.
No,
I follow. I follow.
You change even when you are not Sunnah.
I am following the Sunnah of Rasulullah.
Yes, what
I am Sunni. I am not Shia. I am Muslim.
My brother.
Okay, we have the number.
I am Muslim.
Let us read the Fatiha and ask God to protect us from Shaitan. We are begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from Shaitan and to make our worship, devotion, study, and everything devoted to Allah alone in accordance with His word for Al Fatiha. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Let us go back to our regular program. Is there any questions in the things that we said?
Does the Zakat, if you give the Zakat to your family, if they're non-believers, does that matter?
No, they have to believe. God is not so given to your believing parents.
Let's say I'm
spending
my Christmas card.
Is that my Zakat? Well, you have to calculate. See, Zakat has to be calculated. So I receive this income, 2.5% of this month, and then give it to a sister who's going to college, and add more if you want. Because the 2.5% is the minimum. You can add any more. And yes, the answer is yes. You can consider it. No, it's not automatic Zakat. You have to have the intention. You have to be aware that you are taking a proportion of your income to give to your sister as Zakat. You know, you cannot inadvertently create a loan trade with that. You have to make the intention and do the loan trade. And Zakat is exactly the same thing. The prayer is a specific thing to do, and you must have the intention to do it. So, as long as you specifically make the intention that you are giving the Zakat to your sister, then the account is satisfied. That's different. You are an independent person. They will fall under the Aqrabi, the relative.
There is a verse in the Quran that it says that all the fruits are male or female. Where is that? I don't know. I couldn't find it. All the kinds of fruits.
Everything is in pairs.
Even food.
Even the atom, not the atom, there is neutron and proton. I mean, there is a positive and negative. Electron
and proton. At the beginning you started from us being in heaven of course. I did a question. I want to know if God knew that us and Satan might go against him, why he created us? If I can ask the
question. That's a very good question, but I think we just used it before. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will to give us the freedom of choice, because if you are able to create robots, you can create three kinds of robots. One robot will do anything you say. Vacuum the house, it will vacuum the house. Wash the dishes, yes sir. You can also create a robot with a mind. They wash the dishes, they say no, I don't want to wash the dishes. Or yes, that's the second kind. The third kind would be the kind with a mind who appreciates you. So, appreciates you enough and loves you enough that when you say, back in the house, yes sir. Even though he has the choice, say no. Wash the dishes, yes sir. So, obviously, you will want the third kind. And this is what God will to create creatures who will serve him and worship him with their own choice. Not by force.
So, and you said angels are the robots?
No. The angels have freedom of choice.
They have.
But they appreciated God, they knew God, and they chose to worship God alone and above His absolute authority. Satan chose not to, definitely.
How we can determine if Shaitan has an influence on us or not?
If you do anything that goes against the Quran, this is a good sign that the Shaitan is directing you. Anything that Satan has one job, pushing some other name besides God. This is his only job. So if you are devoting your worship to God alone, and you are not concerned with any other names, this is a sign that you're doing the right. The moment any other name comes up, the sign is in the picture.
Yes, I mean when I'm praying, sometimes I'm praying, but instead I'm thinking about some other things, like I have lots of problems. I'm thinking about job, or I'm thinking about, you know, everything. Does that mean Shaitan has influence on me?
Sometimes Shaitan will try to miss waswasing. So this is why God asked us to seek refuge from the waswas. Because he whispers in our ears and reminds of everything in the world when you get up to pray.
Mm-hmm.
But don't let this bother you. What should be done in the prayer is that you make sure that from the beginning of the prayer to the end of the prayer, there is no other name except the name of God. Because the minute you mention any other name, you have committed shirk. Shirk means more than one. And you have disobeyed God and you have disobeyed the Prophet when you mention any other name in the Salah. This is based on أقم الصلاة لذكري which is singular observe the Salah to commemorate me singular even though God speaks in the Torah tense in the many places in the Quran. The other is وأن المساجد لله فلا تدعو مع الله أحد, that the places of worship belong to God, do not call on anyone else besides God. So if anything causes you to mention any other name of God, this will be safe and worthy.
How we can determine if Shaitan has influence on God?
Well, this is what I said, by deviating from God alone.
But no, I mean talking about, for example, I'm drinking, I'm doing lots of things wrong. I know it is wrong, but it's my choice, and you said we have a choice that we can, you know, do it. But how do I know it's my choice, or is it Shaitan, or whether it is a God, or...
But if you're unhappy for any reason, it is a shaitan.
I'm not happy, I'm enjoying it. For example, I'm doing it, I'm enjoying it.
When you're asking me, I'm asking
every question.
Yeah, the answer is anything that will cause you to put any other name besides God will be from shaitan. If you are working, living, doing things, and you're satisfied with God alone, then you will be
satisfied.
Thank
you.
Is there any criteria for the new messenger in Quran?
Yes, we are confused.
Yeah.
Okay, first of all, in Surah 3, verse 81, we learn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made a covenant with all the prophets, including the Prophet Muhammad, that after they deliver the messages, the messenger will come to confer, consolidate, purify all the messages. And so this is a clear, straightforward prophecy in the Quran. The traditionalists and the idol worshippers who raised Muhammad against his will, they claimed that Muhammad was the messenger who will come after all the prophets. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always clarifies this in the Quran. When we go to Surah 33, verse 7, we learn that Muhammad was one of the prophets who made that covenant. So, also the Quran says that Muhammad is not the last messenger. Muhammad was the last prophet because he wrote the last scripture. Back to verse 81 of Surah 3, the prophet or Nabi is defined as one who is given a book. When Abdullah mithaqa al-Nabiyyin, lama ataytukum min kitabin hikmah. The book, the scripture, is given to the prophet. Thumma ja'akum rasulun musaddiqun lima ma'akum. So the messenger confirms existing scripture and does not bring a new scripture. And the thumma means afterwards. So after all the prophets have come, including the Prophet Muhammad, as we see in 33:7, a messenger is supposed to come and consolidate all the messages and confirm them and purify them into one. Besides this, we go to the statement of Surah 33, verse 40, which says that Muhammad was not the last messenger, but the last prophet because he wrote the last scripture. مَا كَانَ مُحَمَّدٍ أَبَا أَحْدٍ مَا رِجَالِكُمْ. Muhammad was not the father of any of your men, وَلَكِنْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, a messenger of God, وَخَاتَمَ النَّبِيِّينَ, and the final prophet. If, as some people claim, every Nabi was a messenger, or every Nabi was a messenger, but also a messenger of the prophet, if the Nabiyyin include the Mursaleen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not say Rasulullah. So, in Makana Muhammad and Abu Ahad and Jaliq, Muhammad is not the father of any of your men, but Lakin Khatam al Nabiyyin, the last prophet. And this will cover the prophets and the messengers. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Quran is very accurate, said, Rasulullah, A messenger of God, Muhammad in the Jews. So we learn from this that Muhammad is not the last messenger. There are many other places in the Quran that have this indication also in Surah 7, where it says, Ya Bani Adam, or children of Adam, Imma Ya'tiyatakum Rasulun Minkum, when messengers come from among you, Yatluna Alaykum Ayatina, reciting our revelation, فَمَنْ أَمَنَ وَأَصْلَحَ فَأُولَكُمْ مُحْتَقُونَ. Obviously, God is not talking to the dead, He's talking to the people in the future after the Quran. So when messengers come to you, you shall believe and listen. So, we have this Quranic principle that Muhammad was the last prophet but not the last messenger. And the verses that come after this, verses 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, and 91. All these verses say that anyone who rejects this Quranic prophecy is not a Muslim anymore. He is dismissed from God's grace. And this is what I have in the new issue of the Muslim perspective, which I will give some of very bad. You can look at it. So anyone who, of course, because they do not believe the Quran, anyone who rejects the premise that Muhammad was not the last messenger is no longer a believer. He does not believe God. Does not believe the Quran, does not believe the words written out of Muhammad's mouth. So therefore, as believers in the Quran, we must know that Muhammad was not the last messenger, he was the last prophet, he was the last human. So if Muhammad was not the last messenger, and as we see in Surah 3 verse 81, if a messenger is to come after him, what does he look like? We have to ask ourselves, what does the messenger look like? Human being. What are his qualifications? What will he advocate? How can we distinguish the true messenger from the fake messenger? How do we know if this person is alive or telling the truth? So all these questions must be examined by all of us. As soon as we pass these obstacles, I have here, if you remind me, I'll give you a sheet that is a step-by-step proof for all these things, and it begins by the Quranic principle that Muhammad is not the last messenger. What are the criteria of the true messenger? How do you tell if the messenger who comes after Muhammad is a true one or a fake one? We heard of many messengers, people claiming to be messengers, Joseph Smith, Baha'ullah, Ghulam Ahmad. We heard all these people claiming to be messengers. How can you tell if the messenger is true or fake? The criteria, right? The criteria is, first of all, he must advocate the worship of God alone. Because this is the first commandment in all the scriptures, in all the messages. And God goes in the Quran through the messengers, one by one, all of them, and says the same statement after after each one. يَا قَوْمَ عَبُدُ اللَّهَ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَهٍ غَيْرُهُ. All my people worship God, we have no other God besides me. يَا قَوْمَ عَبُدُ اللَّهَ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَهٍ غَيْرُهُ. The same expression for everyone in the messenger. Therefore, this is the first criteria. The true messenger must advocate the worship of God alone. He must advocate the destruction of all idols and all idol worship. And must advocate the upholding of the word of God alone, not the words of men, no matter who those men are. This is your first criteria. Somebody comes to you and says, I'm a messenger of God. This is the first judgment that you must, or the first criteria you must satisfy. That this person must be advocating the worship of God alone. The second criterion is, what was the second? I want to put in the same order. This is number three. The proof, yeah. Excuse me. He must be supported by a God-given proof. God says in the Quran, you demand proof. Have to Burhana proof. Well, have to Burhana. So a person comes to you and says, I'm God's messenger. You say, what is your proof? The third one is, he doesn't ask for wage for himself. He doesn't ask you for money. Because if money enters the picture, it's a whole new issue. So these are the three criteria. Advocating the worship of God alone. Proof from God that he is God's messenger. Moses came and he threw the staff, became a serpent. That was the proof from God. The ninth sign, nine miracles. Jesus revived the dead and healed the blind and the lepers. That was the proof, miracle from God. Prophet Muhammad's miracle was the Quran. So everyone who comes and claims to be a Muslim must have proof. And third, he must not ask you for money. If a messenger flunks any of these three criteria, he is not a messenger, he is a liar. Also, I must emphasize here that the message is the important thing, not the messenger. As the first generation and the unified message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the purified Quran, we must destroy all human idols. This is the first thing. We must be devoted to God alone. Because the idols themselves do not want to be idolized. Jesus does not want to be idolized. And as we know from the Quran and from the Bible, he will disown the people who idolize him. In Matthew 7:21-23, we read that Jesus will say, many will come to me on the day of judgment and tell me, Lord, Lord. Before that it says, none of those who call me Lord will make it to heaven. Many of you will come to me and say, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not performed miracles in your name? Then I will say to them, out of my sight, I don't know you. Jesus will disown them. This is also in the Quran. Muhammad will disown the people who idolize him. And we see this in Surah 46. I'm going to read it for you. Got the wrong story. Listen to this verse. Surah 46, verse 5. It says, وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ. Who is farther astray? مِمَّنْ يَدْعُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. Who mentions or calls upon besides God, مَنْ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ. One who cannot respond to him. إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامِ. Until the day of judgment. وَهُمْ عَنْ دُعَائِهِمْ غَافِلُونَ. And they are completely unaware of their calling. وَإِذَا حُشِرَ النَّاسِ. When the day of judgment comes, the day of summer, كَانُوا لَهُمْ أَعْدَاءَ. They will become their enemies. The Prophet Muhammad right now is dead. As the Quran says, إِنَّكَ مَيِّتٌ وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ. He is absolutely unaware of the people who are calling on him, which fits this description. And on the day of judgment, he will be an enemy of people who are calling on him. And this is what Shaitan misleads and tricks a lot of people in the name of love. So if you love Muhammad, you have to commemorate him every day. Muhammad is unaware. And as we see in this verse, they are the farthest astray. I'm going to read it again. وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ. Who is farther astray? مِمَّنْ يَدْعُ. Than those who call upon مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. Other than God. مَنْ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ. Those who cannot respond. لَهُ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. Until the day of resurrection. وَهُمْ. This is the idol. عَنْ دُعَائِهِمْ غَافِلُونَ. Are unaware. You tell me, is Muhammad aware of the people who are calling on him? Muhammad is aware of, when you say, please God, I grant Muhammad a reward. He is aware.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by His mercy, the Quran tells us,
Muhammad dead or alive?
Muhammad is dead, but all the shaheeds in the Quran, the shaheed, not Muhammad, even less human being, alright? Listen, Islam. Shaheed is any Muslim who died in God's cause. What the Quran say about the shaheed? وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ قُتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتًا بَلْ أَحْيَاءً
Muhammad is dead.
You can put him in the grave and you can even you know, cut him in pieces, the shaheed in front of you. I mean, you take the shaheed, put him in the casket and put him in the grave. But Allah said in the Quran that this dead in front of you is not dead. So who do we believe, our eyes or the Quran?
We believe the Quran.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, don't believe that those people who died in that cause is dead. They are still alive with God, عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ, with God. And even so, I give them food. That means that a human being can be alive with God, even his body is dead in front of you.
Are they aware of what's happening here?
And, one second. And God is still giving them food, عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ, with nowhere. عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ, رَبِّهِمْ is everywhere. God is everywhere. So this shaheed is with God.
Okay.
Where?
Let's
everywhere.
Muhammad
sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is dead in his body. But he is one of the shaheed. He is Nabi. He is Rasul. He is the high quality, even more than the shaheed. So if the shaheed who is this quality is still alive, Muhammad is still alive.
Okay. Is he aware of what's calling on him? Is he aware of your calling on him?
Muhammad.
Yes or no? Yes or no? Is Muhammad aware of your calling on him or unaware?
I pray to God, God gave him the message.
He's saying that God is Muhammad
Sikr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, of course. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to us, listen and understand. I am an engineer. I am an engineer. So you can pray to me. When you pray to your father is dead. Your father cannot hear you. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take your prayer from your mouth, give it to your father. Tell him to your father, I have a beautiful gift from your child.
How did you get that?
That's what I'm saying. If you don't have the hadith of Rasulullah, you are missing a lot.
You are saying that Quran is not complete, so that's why
you're saying. No, I'm saying that Quran is complete.
So you don't need it to be complete.
Not only that, the Quran mufassal. If you read the Quran, I don't remember the ayah, it says that you got to pray for your dead.
You know what I mean? This is the
text of Quran. I have the dictionary, but I don't have it with me, but I can read it to me. Okay, let me tell you something. Can we pray for our fathers if they die or not?
We're talking about awareness.
Can we pray?
It doesn't help him. Yeah, if God wants, it will help him.
If God wants, it will help.
It really doesn't make any difference, because whatever we do, when we are alive,
When I pray to God, God take my prayer to my father. When I pray to Muhammad, God take my prayer to Muhammad.
What's the point to take the prayer to your father?
So Muhammad, he is saying that Muhammad is aware of his calling on him.
God give him the message. That's what I'm saying. God give the message to everybody.
The ayah says,
if you ask for Allah, Allah is very close to you. إِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. If you ask me, I am very close to you.
You say Muhammad.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah.
Seek God alone. No.
Da'a means pray for everything. You can pray for $1 million. You can pray for health. You can pray for somebody to be saved. You can pray for your dead father to be saved and go to paradise. Anything you pray to Allah, He's very close to you.
I mean, if I can pray just for myself to be saved,
not for yourself,
that's enough.
For your family too.
And then you say the one person who can do all, for example, my father,
yes,
he can do robbery, all the bad things. And then when he dies, I pray to God, please,
yes,
don't take him to the hell.
It's not to get to accept it from you or not.
No, everybody is so individual. This is very obvious.
Okay, I will tell you just one of the imams saw a man stealing an apple, giving it to the poor guy. He steal an apple from the man, giving it to the poor guy. So he went to him.
No,
it's a true story.
It's not hadith.
I am giving you one of the imam, I know him. Alright? I know the imam, by the way. He saw the guy taking an apple, taking it from, stealing it from here, giving it to the poor guy. He went to him and he said, what did you do? He said to him, according to the Quran, I made hasana. So God will multiply my hasana. Hasana means good deed. God will multiply my hasana, which I give to the poor guy. And I made bad deed, so God will excuse me for one bad thing and will give me 10 good things. So I am winner now. I made 9 out of it.
Oh my God.
The imam said to him, what happened is that you stole it, so God writes it for you bad deed. You gave it, but didn't accept it from you. So you are the loser.
How did you know it didn't accept it?
No, he gave him the example. He said, how do you know that God is writing it for you, but for sure you are a thief? And it is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fayyib, Allah is beautiful, is good thing, He will not accept the haram from you.
What is the relation between the subject? Muhammad, answer your prayer or not. He said, answer. Quran says, I want to ask you a question. Is Muhammad min dunillah?
No.
Is Muhammad other than God?
No.
Is not God?
No.
Is other than God?
He's a human like you and I.
Yes. Okay.
Other than God.
Allah says in Quran, chapter 13, verse 14. Please, not وَالَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِنْ دُونِهِ in the meaning of مِنْ دُونِهِ everybody. Muhammad also مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِنْ دُونِهِ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُونَ لَهُمْ بِشَيْءٍ. That is the answer. Muhammad cannot answer because Allah said he cannot answer. Okay.
So you put this with the other verse that says, who is farther astray from those who call on people who cannot respond to them. Man, the same word, man la yastajibu lahu ila yawm al-qiyam. Who is farther astray than those who call upon
people? You are missing Muhammad and the idol, you know. Muhammad is Minduni. No.
Is God? Muhammad is God?
He's not God.
He's Minduni Allah.
Minduni Allah.
But we don't call Muhammad. We never call to ask Muhammad give me money. I never did that. Nobody ever did that.
You're calling on him.
No, but I say, my Lord, I like you to take me to paradise. Before you take me to paradise, take Muhammad. Okay? This is how much I love him.
We have sufficient for him. We have sufficient that Allah will
help you. I love him. I am the man who are, if my father did something with me, I love my father and I am proud to say it. If my father gave me his money, his soul, his life, I always go everywhere and say, I love my father. But if somebody deny his father and say, my father didn't do anything to me, God did it to me, my father didn't do anything to me, I would assume this guy is arrogant and he doesn't even appreciate his own father.
No, God's will. Your father
is living
God.
But I love my father anyway.
I have a question for this fellow here. Do you have any doubt that Muhammad is going to heaven?
No.
Do you have any doubt that Muhammad will be in the highest place in heaven?
No.
So why do you ask God to put him in the highest place in heaven?
I love him.
Do you have any doubt that you're going to heaven?
Yes.
You have doubt that you're going to heaven?
Yes.
You want to go to heaven?
Yes.
Do you want to go to heaven?
I do.
If Muhammad, you know he's going to heaven, the highest place.
But
why do you pray to God?
You see, there is one. Yes.
If I say,
I am a non-statement. I don't believe in Muhammad, but I don't believe in God. I have come here to live. I haven't learned anything from it, but I hope that I get to say that I can start to leave this country. And I don't see any point in which you are living.
You did not stop representing the state.
Yeah, because he doesn't believe in God.
This is the first time I come here. I want to start to
learn
from it.
Yeah.
I don't care about.
Well, you see, you are get caught in this thing. There's a fight against Islam. And you are the prison. You are in the prison now to witness one of the worst historical tragedy that people fighting Allah in Islam. People fighting Islam in the Muslim heart. They didn't go to the Christian, they came to the Muslim to take Muhammad, to take Jesus,
okay,
to take Moses, to take Ibrahim.
He doesn't believe in any God, so
that's
what are you going to talking about?
So you came to the wrong place in the wrong time.
Thank you.
To know about God.
Well,
you like to know about God? You like to know about God? I have the mind. I have the time. And
I
have
a believer, and I don't
get anything
out of this. So,
did you understand one thing?
I believe in God. See, I'm not stoning you, I'm not cheating.
Yeah.
And what you guys are talking here, if you call it that, just it's something you guys know very much about.
Yes, we don't know anything
about. So it's like we're not using any of
this. That's it. Okay, now let's you can contact Dr. Khalifa later on and ask your question. Let everybody else have a chance to talk and know whatever they want to know and hear. Because you're here, if we want to hear your.
But if you have a false Francis. He lied to Parivash telling her that he believed in the miracle of the Quran.
Yes.
And he believed as we do in upholding the Quran alone and worshiping God alone. And when he came here, he is pushing Satan's point of view. And
I came to meet Dr. Khalifa personally to know more what is his message. And from the first thing I heard from him, I knew that he is the enemy of God. From the minute I saw his face,
okay, we don't want to hear your, what is your idea?
No, like
him.
You
are
telling us that is not
that. What is the proof that I'm an enemy of God?
Because you calling these people, when I prayed after you and I am sorry that I did, this man didn't even say, we love Muhammad in his prayer just for one time. One time.
Okay, that is fine. Sure, do it. Next time you're going to take the masters in
your
eyes.
Let me finish.
The real Muslim and the people that pretend they are Muslim. I'm so glad that he's here because God is sending him to clarify everybody. Really, how much I was before, because I was before exactly like Mr. Muslim. Okay? Right now, I'm really. Submit a God, because I know everything is a God. Okay, my professor is working in mathematics. Oh, yeah, he's a very good man, he helped me. But the subject was mathematics, okay? I forgot my professor, I know the mathematics. Muhammad was, I believe Muhammad, I like Muhammad, I like Jesus, I like Moses. But only thing is Muhammad is a God, the subject is a God. Finish. I'm so glad that you was here and show everybody what difference between a real Muslim and the very
excuse me,
very
excuse me. The other thing I'd like to add is that we...
Before we pray Maghrib, I have one thing that's very important to share with you, okay? This is the most important principle in the Quran. And it says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكْ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. God says that everything is forgivable except for shirk. Shirk means if you have a business and you are the only owner, this is so-called a sole proprietorship. If you have somebody else with you, this is shirk. You have a shirk. And God says that the only unforgivable offense, the only one, is shirk. Therefore, if you want to guarantee to go to heaven, or if you commemorate and devote yourself and the worship of God alone, you will not commit this shirk. The only unforgivable offense. An intelligent person will say, if this is the only unforgivable offense, I will run away from the slightest suspicion of shirk, of putting anything with God, no matter who that anything is, or what that anything is. Because this is the only unforgivable offense. Now this fellow here is using the name of Muhammad. That is not the name of God. We are talking about God alone. He is saying, put Muhammad with God. This may not be shirk. Maybe it is not shirk. Maybe it is perfectly alright. But it also may be, this is a maybe. It may be shirk. Therefore, you can take a chance and pray to Muhammad or to Jesus or Hussein or whatever you want, and then find out in the day of judgment whether it is maybe right or wrong. But what is absolutely sure to be correct is devotion to God alone. Because God repeats in the Quran, repeats this verse, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرْ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ. God does not forgive the putting of someone next to him, with him. وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكْ لِمَنْ يَشْرَكْ. So, the thing that is absolutely guaranteed to be correct is لا إله إلا الله. And devotion to God alone. God, in Surah 29 says, God is the one who created you. God is the one who provides for you. God is the one who Allah who decides your life or death. God is the one who resurrects you. God is the one who will put you in heaven or hell. Muhammad has no role here. He did not create you. He has no role in creating you. He has no role in providing for you. He has no role in deciding your life. He has no role in resurrecting you. He has no role in putting you in heaven or hell. In Surah 54, we read that God is the one who makes you happy or miserable. وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَضْحَكَ وَأَبْكَى. God is the one who rich you, makes you rich or poor. وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَغْنَى وَأَقْنَى. Muhammad has no role in this. So, an intelligent person will look at this law, which is that God forgives everything except shirk, and will run away as fast as he can from the slightest suspicion of shirk. So this is the only guarantee of shirk. And as you witness tonight, God sent this man, he's God sent to show you how the traditional Muslims push another name with God, which is the only unforgivable thing.
I'd like to ask something that we have the great honor for not only Muhammad, but the other messengers as well, and that's by showing that we are following his path. I mean, the way we are doing the Salat and the Zakat and the fasting and all the other rules and regulations that God has asked us to do, that shows that we are following the book which has been revealed to Muhammad by God, and this is a great respect and honor. So that doesn't mean what you say, that we hate Muhammad or we kind of dishonor him or disrespect him. This is not true at all. Like the other thing that you said, that which was not true.
Respecting Muhammad is respecting the word that came out of his mouth and obeying the Prophet. These are the first people who disobeyed the Prophet. And the God said this in Surah 25, verse 30. وَقَالَ رَسُولُ يَا رَبِّ إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْزُورًا. That the Prophet Muhammad is saddened and upset and embarrassed in the day of judgment to say, my people have deserted this Quran.
Not Bukhari.
Because they go to Bukhari and didn't say, Ya Rabbi, Ya Rabbi, Inna Qawm Ittakhadu Al Hadith Wa Sunnah Mahzura. Or Ya Rabbi, Inna Qawm Ittakhadu Al Bukhari Mahzura. Said, Ya Rabbi, Inna Qawm Ittakhadu Hadha Quran Mahzura.
The miracle of the Sunnah of Rasulullah, one thing, that nobody can pray two times and fetch and four and four and three and four from the Quran alone. There is nothing in the Quran nothing in the Quran here say, pray two rak'ah for fajr, four rak'ah dhuhr, four rak'ah al-asr, three maghrib, four al-ishr. Nothing in the Quran say that. And okay, where does he have it?
This is the result of ignorance of the Quran. Okay, so
tell me, what do you have?
Because God says, أَفَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ أَبْتَغِي حَكِمًا وَهُوَ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْكِتَابَ مُفَصَّلًا. God says the Quran is mufassalan, fully detailed.
What in heaven?
He says, ما كان حديثا يفترى. This is not fabricated hadith. ولكن تنزيلا.
Where do you have it in the Quran?
وتفصيل كل شيء. And detailing everything. Now, these people do not believe God when he says the Quran is mufassalan, وتفصيل كل شيء. It's fully detailed. They challenge God and say, show me where does it say the rule is for rak'ah. Okay? This is challenging God. In other words, he's saying, okay God, you claim that this book is fully detailed. If you are right, God, show me where does it get the details of Salat. And this blasphemous question results from ignorance. Because the Quran says that the Salat was in existence before the Quran. The Salat, the Zakat, the Hajj, and all these things came through Ibrahim. Islam is not Millat Muhammad. It is not. He doesn't know that. It's ignorance of the Quran that causes these disasters. This religion, Islam, is called throughout the Quran, called Millat Ibrahim. وَقَالُوا كُونُوا هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارَى تَهْتَدُوا قُلْ بَلْ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ تَبَعَ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ. And then the Quran tells us that Muhammad was following Millat Ibrahim. ثُمَّ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ أَنِ اتَّبِعْ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا وَمَا كَانَ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. So the Prophet Muhammad is a follower of Millat Ibrahim. The Quran says in many places which he's not aware of that the Salat existed before the Quran. Therefore, the things in Surah 22, the last verse says, وَجَهِدُوا فِي اللَّهِ حَقَّ جِهَادٍ. Strive in the cause of God. هُوَ اجْتَبَاكُمْ. He chose you. وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. And did not cause any difficulty in your religion. مِلَّةَ أَبِيكُمْ إِبْرَاهِيمِ. This is the religion of your father Ibrahim. هُوَ سَمَّاكُمْ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِ. This fellow here insulted Muhammad and he does not realize that before Muhammad there was light. He does not realize, he thinks light
here. He didn't answer my question.
Muhammad.
He didn't answer my question.
Therefore, if you read Surah 21, verse 73, we know that the Salat and Zakat and all the duties came through Ibrahim. وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْهِمْ فِعْلَ الْخَيْرَاتِ وَإِقَامَ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِيتَاءَ الزَّكَاةِ. And we see in the Quran people who did not believe, they rejected Muhammad even. And they were doing the Salat and Zakat. وَمَا مَنَعَهُمْ أَن تُقْبَلَ مِنْهُمْ نَفَقَتُهُمْ. What prevented the acceptance of the worship